about twisting. Though we would like to believe that we are not in control. Though we would love to believe. Wake up, sleepy head, I think the sun's a little brighter today. Smile and watch the icicles melt away. And see the waters rising. Summer's here to stay. And those sweet summer girls will dance forever. Go down to the shore, kick off your shoes, dive in the empty ocean.
Oh, it's about to be turned up tonight. It's your boy, Concertvis 34. Back from vacation. Shout out to the Wi-Fi at home. Shout out Virginia Beach. The whole 757, what up? Not shout out to the horrible traffic in Northern Virginia. And even in Richmond, man. There are way too many people living in Northern Virginia. Anyway, I will tell you, listen, I had a great time. I was on vacation this past week and a couple of issues. I did not have Wi-Fi. This hotel I was at had horrible, horrible Wi-Fi. Like, it did not even reach my room. Next time, I'm gonna upgrade the where I stay. So I can stream on the road for y'all. But what ended up being a great thing is I had an Instagram live this past Wednesday and got a little bit of a different crowd. Some people that are typically on IG that don't always check out the YouTube side right away. A little bit of crossover. Thank you for everyone who joined us. That IG live is still on my page. Let me show you guys how you can get there if you want to see it. And that intro was from Virginia Beach. It was Dive In. I did a nice little video cut. I love going to the beach and watching sunrise. I mean, who doesn't? But I love Virginia Beach, especially because the angle of the beach is perfect for the sunrise. I know, you know, most coastline is facing the east, but the way Virginia Beach's oceanfront is, it's just like some of the hotels, if you go right in front of them, you can literally, it's perfect. Not that Miami Beach doesn't have it, not that Myrtle Beach, I'm sure there's other great, but like Virginia Beach is by far the best beach on the East Coast that I've been able to capture some amazing sunrises and also not have to worry about the crowds. But again, I go this time of year to the beaches, and I've been to Miami, Virginia Beach. I've been to Connecticut beaches. Most times I go a little later than that. But if you want to check out the stream, it's right here. It's my second post. The whole stream is available for replay straight from the hotel room. I got 37 views. Don't, if you have time, check it out. Again, Instagram handle is ConcertViz34. I also went to an Orioles game last night. I'm a Yankees fan. And on the way back from Virginia Beach, I decided to stop in Baltimore, right? Used to spend summers down in Maryland. Shout out to PG County. Shout out to Anne Arundel County. And I hadn't been to this venue since 2005. Here's some of the scene here. So this was awesome. So they were doing the wave And the game sucked. I mean, both teams were not hitting. The hitting was horrible for both teams, but it was just a nice environment. This is one of my favorite venues outside of Fenway. This is probably number two that I've been to. It's just, it set the standard for MLB ballparks. Anyway, you can check that out on IG. That's on my featured stuff on IG there. Again, Instagram, ConcertViz34. We are going to be talking about Dave Matthews tonight. We're going to be talking about Stefan Lessard tonight and some of the things that, and we're going to talk about Dave Matthews and Tim Reynolds. If we have time at the end, I'm going to answer some questions from Twitter that I was asked this week on air. We'll get to that potentially at the end if we have time. Let me also just put this on. I want to put this stream on Twitter so that people know that we're live here. Just give me one moment. Again, I appreciate everyone for joining us here on YouTube. And everyone who's watching the replay, shout out to everyone who watches these replays here. I appreciate all my support. So let's see. I am live from New York. Just kidding. I believe it's Samantha. Samantha has always been a loyal supporter of the stream. She's like pretty much comments on every video. And I really appreciate her support. Let me see if I can find it. Yep, Samantha Pinkerton. Shout out to Samantha Pinkerton. You were always great. All right, so first topic. Let's go to IG. Dave Matthews will be on CNN in support of refugees. He will allegedly perform a new song. Now, I'm guessing this is like a song never heard before heard. Possibly for the album, possibly geared towards refugees. I don't know. I would be disappointed. Although you never can be disappointed if you don't get your hopes up. If this is actually like a song he played in 2021, I'm not going to lie. I'll be a little disappointed. I hope it's a new song. Like an actual new song, like truly hasn't been heard. And here it is here. So this is exclusive. This is from Twitter. Dave Matthews performing a new song in support of refugees. I think it will be. This is State of the Union with Jake Tapper and Dana Bash. 9 a.m. Eastern, 12 p.m. Pacific. This is tomorrow, April 17th. Now, personally, I don't watch a lot of cable news, because I think all of it is biased, and especially MSNBC and Fox News, I will say that. But I will be tuning into this, and CNN has its own little, like, it gets too dramatic for me, too. I like to get hard news, and unbiased, and that's not on cable news. Doesn't make any money, so unfortunately, you don't get much of it on cable. Support your local newspaper. So this is an exclusive CNN State of the Union. I'm interested again. This is very early. This is 9 a.m. So it looks like it's premiere 9 a.m. and then 12 p.m. Eastern time. So we'll see what happens. I'm guessing it's pre-recorded. Because 9 a.m. unless Dave's in Virginia. Not in a Seattle crib. If he's in the Virginia crib, that's 6 a.m. Pacific time. So I don't know. We'll see. We will all find out when it happens. I don't think this is tied to the new album. I think this is just something, Dave, a song. I think this is just a song. I know on like the Ants Marching Thread, some people are like, oh no, like this is tied to the new album. They're leading this in. I think this is just a separate song. Or a separate cause. You have so many different musicians and artists doing things for Ukraine. I do also like the fact this is just in support of refugees in general. I think that's something that is great, because it's not just about the people of Ukraine who have faced horrible things, but there are people across the world every day that face the violence of many kinds and have to flee their homeland, flee their region of the country for their life, and some of them are die on the way to fleeing. So If this horrible situation in Ukraine can bring awareness to all atrocities across all continents of all walks of life, I really think that's a great thing. So we'll see what happens. But again, I do think this is going to be a song specific to the refugees. I don't think this is going to support the album. Another key example of why I don't think this is just like, this isn't like a cash grab for the new album, it's just an actual separate song, is because during the pandemic, Dave never used Windows as a promotional tool for the pandemic. So if he didn't do that, if that wasn't marketed as, I think this is just going to be a separate song and the album stuff will come in a separate rollout. Be interesting to see how the song sounds. Dave has a great heart, but he doesn't always have the best pen for the warm-hearted songs. The best example of this is Come Tomorrow. This song about, oh, the kids are going to take over and all. Trash. Horrible songwriting. Probably one of the worst songs on Come Tomorrow is Come Tomorrow. Again, great intentions. Great positive message. Horribly executed. So we'll see if we can do something special here. I love Madman's Eyes. Again, that's a song that does hit. So we don't know. It could be something like Come Tomorrow. Or it could be something like Madman's Eyes. We'll see what this thing sounds like. I don't think it'll be as dark as Madman's Eyes, unless it's painting a dark picture for refugees. I think it may be something like as a sign of hope, especially if this is on a benefit for them. So yeah, we'll have to see what happens there. With that, the next thing that we want to get into is Stefan Lessard versus the trolls on Twitter. Now, this is interesting because I have mixed reactions with this. And let's get to this. This little exchange. All right, so let's get to this because I was commenting on this. Yeah, let's zoom in. All right, so this started on April 15th yesterday. So Ted Cruz says, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still sinners. This is Romans 5 and 8. It is a very popular scripture in the Bible. I am a Christian myself, so I am very familiar with this text. Now, this is a shot at Ted Cruz by saying, and then he flew to Cancun. So so it's a shot at Ted Cruz because Ted Cruz left during a power grid outage and horrible situations in Texas outside of El Paso, which is on a separate grid. But the grid collapsed because of the ice, messed up lines and different things. Electricity was hard to get. And Ted Cruz went to Cancun and with his family instead of being with his constituents and with his you know, the people that he works for in his district. So he's sending a shot there. Stefan does not like the conservative Ted Cruz. And then as a reply to the shot that he sent at Ted Cruz, Burrow is the best QB in AFC. And it has his real at sign is at Heist for DMB 41. So he has a Dave Matthews Band. He has a Dave Matthews Band handle. Okay. He has a Dave Matthews Band handle and he's trying to send shots at a band member who has been liberal, who has been far left leaning for pretty much at least the last 20 years. It's been much more present, but it's been longer than that. If you know the band, even better, if you had befriended the band, if people knew different things that they were involved in, even in the late 90s, as far as on the far left of the political spectrum. So the, obviously, this guy, Heist for DMB, is conservative. Stefan is very liberal in his political views. And he makes this comment. And let's just look at this account. All right. It only has 28 followers. He's from Kentucky. Let me be nice to Kentucky, because I do have some great followers out of Kentucky, and some DMB friends, but Kentucky is Kentucky. Anyway, so he joined in November 2021. So one of my criticisms of Stefan is he does kind of argue with accounts that are new, have limited followers, and just were opened up. So for this one, this is not an account that just opened up last month. A lot of these troll accounts, some of these are bots, meaning someone is controlling, like they're automating these responses to cause a rift in Twitter, in social media, right? There's a lot of, you know, talk about the Russian bots in the election causing rifts and causing arguments, spreading it misinformation, trying to trigger a certain base of the of voters with troll. But so this is not one of those accounts. This does seem like this is some sort of Dave Matthews Band fan. The reason is it's November 2021. A lot of bot accounts if this is April 16th, it was started in March or April of 2021. Eventually, it'll get deleted or it'll get abandoned because people realize it's a bot. This person also has a description, like my Twitter page, of what they are about, right? He's an Irish, so Fighting Irish, and Bearcat football, UCLA, and West Virginia hoops. Interesting combo there. So he likes the Fighting Irish and Cincinnati Bearcats, which were both competing for a make or do or die game in their early schedule. And the winner of that game would really have a good shot at the college football playoff, which the Bearcats ended up winning that game. He could be from Cincinnati because he likes the Bearcats and the Bengals, or the Cincinnati area. He likes UCLA and West Virginia. So he really likes, he or she, I'm guessing it's a dude, but they like the bandwagon Irish fan for football and the bandwagon UCLA fan for basketball. So we already know we already know where this is going. And who day, that's a saying for the Bengals. Go Norwood Jesuits. So he's, I'm guessing. Oh, go Mariners. He's got a lot of teams. I'm guessing he's Catholic. He or she's Catholic because they're an Irish fan and they have this Go Norwood Jesuit. So they probably support them. So, and again, this is a troll account. This is now there's some football. Looks like there's some football stuff here. Right. A little bit of political stuff, right? MSNBC. They're probably making fun of him. So this is actually a really good example of what you can face on Twitter. I believe this is a real account because of that specific stuff. But what happens is you have these sports fans that love sports. So he has his Bengals, who they, blah, 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 blah. They love these athletes and they even love this music like DMB, but they have these far right leaning political views. And not only that, there's nothing wrong with having your political views, but they also like to speak up, oh, this liberal, this, da 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 da. So he fires back. All right. So your side flies to Florida to get away from the state's BS COVID policies. Right. So this is a shot back at Stefan. And then there's going to be a quote tweet from Stefan saying, I only fly to Florida to play shows or wrestle alligators and pythons. Not sure who my side is, but nobody I knew flew anywhere to get away from their state's COVID policies. By the way, Florida has some stupid laws and restrictions also. At least weed is legal in my state. So he's in California, right? And he's saying, look, hey, he's sending shots back. Hey, at least we have a freedom to have, recreational marijuana. Florida has these crazy laws and doesn't let people smoke, right? And, and he's saying like he doesn't know anyone personally who flew out of no one he knows tried to leave California for Florida. Now, here's the thing, though. This is what I'll say. A couple of things here. that will go back. And let's actually go back to this original. Let's start off with here. There is a valid criticism, whether you agree or disagree with how much control Stefan has. There is a valid criticism or questioning. Not that, now the way he's definitely trying to get a reaction out of him, but for a band that speaks up against the laws of Texas, for a band that speaks out against what Florida believed in the pandemic, they're doing a bunch of shows in the Deep South. So now, obviously, they know there's many great fans who believe everything that this band does politically in these states, in Florida specifically, in Texas, right? And I can think about people on Instagram and Twitter from these states who would disagree with some of the rhetoric that, you know, the conservative base brings in this. But there is a valid questioning of, hey, if you guys are so adamant about how Florida is and its policies, if you are so upset about what Texas is doing, if you're going to go on stage and talk about some of the things that Texas has done subliminally, right, the rights of women, some of the things they passed, why don't you just not perform there? Why do you need to even get the bag from those two states? Why don't you have all the, you know, why don't you go to other states and have those fans drive elsewhere? If you truly believe in the principle, if it's about principle, right? If it's about principle, then your fans in Florida and Texas should understand why you're not coming there. And you should also then find another state, even if it's a state that, listen, they don't have, they're also a red state, but you believe they're not making the laws that Florida and Texas are. So this is a valid criticism. This is a fair point. You may disagree with it, but there is a fair point to say, look, Florida has these laws. Texas, especially, you know what they just passed. Dave is opposed to what Texas is doing, and he's mentioned that multiple times and played sister to as a stance against what's going on. If you disagree with those policies, don't perform at those shows. This is something that you see from universities. I mean, not university, from the NCAA and from other, like Hollywood, they won't put business in certain places because of bills. So this is a valid criticism. At the same time, right, Stefan has a good point. This poster, Burrow is the best QB in AFC, is saying he's making assumptions that Stefan and his, you know, any of his friends are just like some of the Northeastern politicians who they've been caught down in Florida, like AOC, that lean left and don't like, you know, they criticize the Florida governor, but they got caught in 4K, as the kids say. Caught in 4K just means caught in, you know, high definition, a really high quality shot. Because pretty much now it's amazing some of the camera footage and some of the photos that even like an average iPhone can take catching people in what they call 4K. So anyway, if you hear your kid saying caught in 4K, that's what it means. They were caught in clear, crystal clear, high definition photos or video. You know, some of them were caught in Florida without masks, right? As AOC was in her hubby, right? So Stefan has a great point. He's like, listen, none of the people that I know went to Florida to avoid, you know, California COVID policies. So he's saying, you're assuming I'm just like everyone else that you hear about, because there have been very liberal people that were caught down in Florida. Even California, Democrats were caught in California having these secret, you know, meetups and secret restaurant maskless dinners, even though they were like the governor was saying, hey, no, you can't have any sort of gathering this large, right? We've seen other politicians in the left have these big parties and say, oh, but we have all these stuff. We've seen in Fashion Week, all the celebrities have no mask. Everyone who works there is in a mask at all times. So celebrities are just immune to any COVID. Like, it could still be spread even if you test negative 5 minutes ago. So this poster is trying to assume. Stefan saying, first of all, here are the facts. Right. And then he's going to be posting some of this stuff, right? We grow the best fire, which means the best, you know, marijuana, because it is legal. He got some videos here. And, you know, There's a shout out to Granny. She didn't say a lot of for people in the back. Now, here is what I said. This is how what I responded to. Let's see if we can get here's my biggest takeaway from this. And I actually, you know, I said this because and I don't typically get into politics. I won't go into much detail, but what I will say is, first off, if you don't like the fact, so we get to hear at during the later in the conversation, he says the laws are so bad you fly there to play four shows to collect a check. Virtue signal. This is true. This is the thing. If you truly are about that life, if you're truly that, and this is the danger of being too hard on certain things. If you truly disagree with Florida, then don't play it. That's like I said, that's the one thing I take out of this. That no matter if you agree, you disagree, if you believe a state's ideals or they have laws left, right, center, whatever you think that's too wild, don't go. Now, who are they? Did Rocky Fetz? I don't think he, you know what? I didn't even reply to, I replied to someone else. So I replied to Jeffrey Crisp. Now this poster has 240 followers. Now this is a legitimate account because they joined in February of 2011, right? And they have 240 followers, right? And they're followed by other people in the DMB community, including Stefan Lessard. Stefan followed him, which is kind of weird. He's following this conservative, who's upset. Now this is where we want to focus this on. So he says, "Too bad you just convinced me to skip your shows this summer." Conservatives come to DMB shows too, but not if you're going to put your politics in my face and take my money for those causes, right? So here's the thing. The Dave Matthews Band, going back to Bill Clinton, has put their money towards Democratic causes only. I have never seen Dave Matthews or Stefan Lessard specifically put money towards a conservative candidate or even candidates like Joe Biden, who are more in the who are more left center. They don't even support them. Like if it's not Bernie Sanders or Elizabeth Warren, like if they're not so far left or right, the band doesn't even put their money towards them. I mean, maybe Obama is the most centrist person that they've actually put money towards their campaign. Like if you're not three degrees from Bernie Sanders, they don't support you. They just hope you win over Trump. Like that's the reality. So if that's the case, you should have left the band. That's what I said. If you were sick of live show politics at DMB shows, you probably should have stopped going 20 years ago. I personally do not align with the band's far left political views, but at a show, Dave has 1 to 2 minutes max of political talk. By that, I mean, I am not far, 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 far left, right? That's just my personal opinion. Listen, you could be that. You could believe all that stuff. But I personally, I don't agree with those. Like most of the time, like it's not like I don't disagree with. Listen, some of the cause the band sticks up for, I agree with. Some of them I don't, right? I'm just not that far left in my personal views. And I don't think that the far left does a great job of actually having action speak up for some of the words they try to pander to me with. But and I don't believe anyway, let me stop. But anyway, I don't do that Bernie Sanders. Like I don't. So that's my personal view, and that's okay. Like, I'm not going to shove it down your throat. If you want to support I believe you should support whoever you support, or put everyone on blast and say, look, whether you're Democrat, Republican, liberal, conservative, I need to see actual things that you're doing to help me. Otherwise, I ain't voting for none of y'all. I could still vote for certain things if I see a candidate I like. But if I see nothing from anyone, I ain't vote. I'm going to leave it blank. And none of you are getting my vote. Right? That's a right that we have as Americans too. But my thing is this. If you are a fan of the band, you should not, like, you should already know what the deal is. Dave, so you think Dave's only mentioned, and this is the other thing. This is the only thing. I think Dave's only mentioned, thank you, Mark. He's only 2 to 3 shows in 40 plus shows I've seen. Yeah, he doesn't really mention, like, there's other, if you go to a Roger Waters show, he's going to give you his politics. If you go to a, what was I gonna say? Oh, one of the shows in Ampton. If you go to a Pearl Jam show, right? Eddie Vedder has opinions, right? There are much more politically charged, you know, artists. My thing has always been this. Yeah, it's not that often. And when it happens, it's very, very quick. And if you want to walk out, again, you should have walked out years ago. If that's truly the issue. The problem is, like, 5 or 6 years ago, maybe 10 years ago, people started getting like, oh, if you don't have the same political views as me, I'm walking out, right? Not character. Some people with the politics they have been horrible human beings as far as musicians. And I'll tell you straight up, Kid Rock is the first one I think about. Like, I don't mess with Kid Rock. He's trash. He's just a horrible, like, that I can understand why someone doesn't like Kid Rock, because his actions, how he is, the extent he goes to, it's not just his political views. He's just a jerk. Right? So I really think that it is, like, it's not that bad. For those of you who are upset, you can call out some of the stuff, right? You can definitely say, look, I think, you know, the band says X, Y, and Z. If they don't agree in the legislation, they should do what Hollywood does. What other people personally do, they don't book shows in certain towns or cities or certain states because they strongly disagree with some of the issues that this state has handled horribly. And it actually works, because you think about North Carolina, some of the stuff they had with a bathroom bill, they changed their tune and boom, it worked. So you can use your power however you want to. But if you're going to take a hard stance, you need to be about that life. Now, with Stefan, right? What do I think about Stefan? With Stefan, I think he shouldn't waste his time. Now, I think that something like this, this comment here, and this is why I responded to this. These type of things that, oh, I'm not going to your show because you got too political. No, I've been like, no, Stefan, but listen, I've been, and again, this is a legitimate account. Stefan follows them. Right. But I think that, like, a comment like this. Like, let's see Rock, right? 9 followers joined April 2021. So this is, but still, he has 9 followers. So, like, don't even, if someone doesn't have, and this isn't like a knock, but if they have 9 followers, that's a very low count. So don't even reply to this person. Even me, like, I wouldn't be offended. I have under 1,000 followers. If he didn't reply to me, I would never be offended. Actually, he follows me, right? Rocky Phelps. But this is, I think this is a valid opinion. Now, if he wants to make an opinion, fine. Like, Stefan can do whatever he wants, but it's not worth it. It's not worth it to reply to this, this at all. And it doesn't do, like, what does this do? Now, Stefan, again, he's the man. He could do whatever he wants. But what's the end game? All right, you're telling these trolls X, Y, and Z. The thing with Twitter, if you're not on Twitter, I mean, listen, I do find good in Twitter. But the thing with Twitter is a lot of it is there's always someone who's going to disagree with you. There's always someone who's going to think you're ugly. There's always going to be someone who has going to try to do something to bring you down. And that's the reality. You have to, part of Twitter is you can't, like, you shouldn't be reading the comments in Twitter if you are at a certain level of success, because it's just going to be depressing. So that's what I think about that. there are some points that you can say, listen, I think this person could say that, but there are also some points that are hypocritical on this side. Again, I truly believe the strongest example is people saying, oh, you're getting too political. This is the first year I'm not going to go to a show because you're too political. No, they don't do a lot of stuff during the show. If at all, it's rare that they talk politics. It's only Dave on stage that will say something politically. What they say outside of the shows, listen, you can agree or disagree or say what you want, but that's not at the show. So to bring up that point, it's a weak point. So that's what I believe. All right, that's all the politics for this show. But I want to bring up next Dave and Tim at CMAC. Now, I did mention this in the live stream because this was announced earlier in the week. I did also mention in a previous show that it was going to be the Sunday after Camden. That's what Ants Marching Forms, the powers that be, the people who knew things in advance, they were saying CMAC was going to be on this date. So you're going to have a couple of things here. You're going to have on Friday, July 15th, you're going to have Camden Night 1. On Saturday, July 16th, you have Camden Night 2. On Sunday, you have July 17th, you have Dave and Tim at CMAC. This is a quick turnaround. They can take a plane up to up. That's what I think they're going to do. Take a plane up. They could drive the gear there. They could put it in the PJ because all they need is a couple guitars, a couple acoustics, and some cords, and you connect it to the PA. Tim may have some pedals. Yeah, he'll have some pedals there. Dave may have a tuner or something like that. He may not, but you don't need much. It'll be a quick turnaround. But my concern for this show is actually, I hope Dave's voice is able to make it through because he's going to be doing Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I went to a SPAC Night 2 show in 2018 where the next day they were in Montreal, I believe it was, for a festival, a rare festival in Quebec.
Let's see.
Where was SPAC? Okay. So they went to Quebec City, Quebec. Plains of Abraham, which is Plains d'Abraham, D apostrophe Abraham. Plains d'Abraham in French. So they did 13, 14, and 15. And then he had one day off and did Jones Beach. So that was a crazy run. And this was a full band Dave Matthews Band show. Now, what happened, I think they did a great job, but I think the double encore that they were doing in years prior here and there at SPAC was cut because they had to do a full show. And they did end on a 16-minute two-step, which was awesome. They did the number 40. But I thought that the big – and there was some great stuff, right? A Liberation of JTR, a bartender, first bartender, I believe, with Buddy Strong. Yeah, because it was a tour debut. It was the first bartender with Buddy Strong. I heard that, and it was amazing, right? You had a – but this was – like this night too had some special moments, but there were a lot of duds, right? You had a Satellite to Come On was okay. But then you have a Sledgehammer by You Here On Out, okay. Right, Crash Into Me. That song's not played every night, right? You had a Steady As We Go. I would have rather had something like What You Are Here. But Steady As We Go was pretty nice. It wasn't horrible. And he had an awesome encore. But I'm just worried about Dave's voice in the playing. Yeah, Mark, I think you had a comment. I just saw it. Were you there? Yeah, I was at SPAC 2018. I was at SPAC Night 2, though. And Dave was at – the picture was posted, I think, a couple weeks – let me see if I can find it. There was a picture of Dave sitting down, and that was at SPAC Night 2 2018. Let's see if we can find it. I thought I saw it somewhere. Maybe it was... Maybe it was posted somewhere else. But there was a picture of Dave sitting down. No, that's Dave and Tim. I thought I saw a picture of it somewhere. I don't know. I don't see it. Maybe it was like one of the Facebook groups I'm a part of. But there was a picture from that night where Dave actually sat down for a hot second. He kind of had to catch his breath. I think he was just, you know, crazy SPAC weekend and just ran out of energy. But I mean, they put on a great, they closed the show real well, but there was some hit or miss stuff there, and it is what it is. But Dave and Tim at CMAC. Now, what's interesting is I would almost go, like, if I had to choose between Camden. Now, this is assuming, again, I have other big venues. But if I had five to six, if I had even three to four shows, and it was like Camden or two nights at Camden or CMAC, I would almost pick CMAC because Dave and Tim, no matter what they play, make me happy. No matter what they do, I've said this before, I'll say it again. Dave and Tim just, it's so much more intriguing in 2022 to see a Dave. Like, again, the full band will complete you. A great full band show will make you feel much more complete than any Dave and Tim show as far as like, oh, I got this awesome experience of all these amazing people. Dave and Tim are amazing. I get, there's no lows in a Dave and Tim show really for me. It's just, it's all great. It's all raised. The bar is raised. It just doesn't get as high as some point. At some points in the in a full band show. So Mark says those Gorge Night 3. Yeah, the Gorge Night 3 get really rough with Dave's voice. 2021 Railbird Fest, he was okay. Shorter show though. It's hit or miss. Usually always hits him at the Gorge. I agree. Dave and Tim is a concern. Now, but the Dave and Tim show, the musicality of it, the acoustic guitars, hearing Dave's guitar is what I would go for. So even though I say I'm worried about Dave's voice, the Dave and Tim shows are awesome. Now, if we look at Railbird, the interesting thing about Railbird was they started off with two-step, and then they just did their cookie-cutter festy. And I think the Railbird was because, again, clearly because the night one of Railbird, there was no DMB because it was a festival. So DMB only had one. They had a headlining set for night two. The first day, they actually ran out of water, which, by the way, I said someone's from Kentucky. That's such a Kentucky thing to do, you idiots. You ran out of water in the Midwest in the middle of, like, the summer months. And, the grounds at Neyland. Okay, so they did they did Star Lake. Oh, I remember hearing the Star Lake show, right? And I remember the Virginia Beach poster. Because it's so the Virginia Beach, that's right. They had an awesome show at Star Lake. They then went to Virginia Beach and had a legendary poster, and then they went to Railbird. Right. But it was a shorter show, right? Dave and Tim is going to be, you know, a little bit more lengthier than a festival headlining set from Dave Matthews Band. But the point is, they started off with two-step, and then it just went, like I said, it went to, let's pull it up, right? Because you have two-step, and right away they play Can't Stop in the second spot, which needs to stop, right? All this cookie-cutter stuff. Now, they had a Nancy's in the Warehouse, pretty cool. Don't Drink and Jimmy Think to Me are stuff that needs to go away. Same thing with I Want a New Judge. They did a Brown Sugar. Now, this was awesome, the Satisfaction. But really, Sledgehammer, Crush, Grace You with the Third Verse is this, you know, nice thing. Crush is, I don't want to discount Crush, but it's like, it's Crush. Great song, but you get it a lot during the tour for the most part. If you go to more than three or four shows, you're probably going to get Crush. Even if you go to four shows, you're probably going to get Crush if you go to four shows. So, because, we can do the math. Was it 13 times 4? Because it was played 13 times. Right. There's about 52 shows. So a quarter of the time the song is played. 13 plays last year. you know, you have around 40 to 50 shows a year. So, yeah. So anyway, that's what I think, that the Dave and Tim is more intriguing to me. And that's why I'm going to, the Sound on Sound Fest, because I love Dave and Tim. And honestly, I mean, I hope I have like a little bit of personal space. I hope it's not too crowded in the GA where I'll be. But like, I don't even, for Dave and Tim, it is nice to be closer. And I don't want to be on a lawn where you can't hear. If I could be on the lawn and hear everything, that's fine. And see, and at least see them from a distance. Like the SPAC lawn is not ideal for that. But I don't really have to be that close for Dave and Tim. I can just enjoy the greatness of them. That's how great they are. Like, it doesn't matter where I am. It's just, I know I'm going to have a ball because they sound so great. But for a DMB show, I like to see the stage presence and all the band members interacting, smiling, laughing. Like, it is nice to not be on the lawn, at least be in the upper pavilion, if not closer. So, I think that's going to be great. I do want to go to some questions. Now, I'm going to pull it up on my phone and then answer it, because I did get asked a bunch of questions while I was on vacation, kind of all in the same day. And I told a Don Dingo, which is Jen and Hines' burner account. I said, like, listen, I don't know everything. But so they had a couple of questions. The first one is, let us know what song spoke to you. It's easy to post a set list. What's your favorite songs amongst that BS? A song that spoke to me. I mean, What You Are. I will all, like, What You Are at MSG, that song just spoke to me. Like, it just was, the whole message of that song hit me when it was played. Another song is The Stomp. It just, again, the message of that, like the rhythm of the song. And I wonder if you come along. Like, I just, that song always speaks to me. You Never Know. You Never Know is another song. Like, the message of that song is so powerful there. Another question is, have you ever cried at Dave Matthews? At a Dave Matthews Band song. So at a concert, I've never cried for a DMB song. I mean, I think in losing loved ones, I probably was listening to DMB and was crying at some point. That's the only thing I can really think of, is just when I've gone through of having to say goodbye to a loved one. Another question I answered, should Nancy's always be followed before Warehouse? My answer was essentially that for the most part, 75% of the time, Nancy should always be followed by Warehouse. But I do like some of the mix-ups where they have Warehouse in the encore. I do like when they have, you know, they just play one of the songs. And because it gives you that idea that it's not always going to be an auto segue. If it's an auto segue, it then can kind of make things mundane. Like, even if the most, again, 75% of the time should be played back to back, Nancy's The Warehouse, especially with the stop time intro they brought back for some of the shows last year. It's interesting. Some of the shows had stop time, some of them didn't. Excuse me. It's been a long day. I woke up this morning and drove from Maryland back to Connecticut. And the day before that, I had driven like from Virginia Beach to Maryland, which is just a crazy corridor. But yeah, I think 75% of the time it should be. Let's see, another one. Should number 27 be played as frequently as Satellite? I said no. Number 27 is actually a great song in moderation. If it is played too much, like the whole Sick of You, Sick of Me, and the Sick of Sickness, like if that's played every night, I think I would be sick of it. Because it's not played as much, the rarity of number 27 makes it great. Even if it was played a little bit more, I wouldn't have a problem with it. I caught it at the Gorge. I caught it another time in, I think it was 2013, 2014. So I think it's a great song, but I just think it needs to be in moderation. Let's see, another question that we have. Does anyone else go to DMB hoping for a Big Eye Fish opener, or am I too old for that S? Bleep, 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 bleep. I would love a Big Eye Fish opener. I don't think I've ever had a fish open, Big Eye Fish open. I've had it early in the set. Could be wrong. But I go to every show thinking the Stone's going to open. My first show, we're almost hitting the anniversary. You guys got to remind me if I forget. May 25th, 2012. Actually, Copperpot's post. Shout out to Copperpot. It'll remind me because he'll probably post from that. But that was a Stone opener, and it was the best opener I've had. Like, I've had Stone open Mansfield 21, but it's just that the Stone opener is just the best. Let's see. I think that was kind of the – those were kind of the questions, and I'll try to timestamp this for Jen and Hines so you guys can hear this, but thank you guys for your comments. I did say, hey, just one – it would actually be good. One question a day if you have a DMB, but they like bombarded me. What do you think of this? What do you think of that? What's your credit score? What's this? What's your social security number? Like, they were asking for a lot of different things all at once. It was, especially I was on the road traveling. So it's like, well, chill, homie, chill. Love you, Jen. Love you, Hines, but chill. Like, yeah, y'all sharing too many things at the same time. So that's what I feel about that. If you guys let me know if you guys have any questions before we go. Yes, the blackjack. Yes, this was also a special moment. And it's one of those things I hear about fish fans. They like get something rare at their first show, but like even for fish, they like may not play it the same after that, or they may not play it at all for a year or two, or more than a year or two. Even with fish playing out their catalog. There's some stuff that you may get once and then you may never ever get it again because it's so rare. So, but like I said, if you have any questions or if you guys have questions for me, I'll try to answer them. But yeah, that blackjack was pretty cool. At that show, it just was like, this thing is epic. It's building up. It's building up to something. So, yeah, definitely. Definitely dope. So, I don't know if there's any more questions, but that's pretty much all I had. Again, we have nothing. Oh, if you weren't on Instagram Live, one of the things I heard is that the band is in its final stages of I think mastering, and the album will come out quarter three or quarter four of 2022. That's what I heard from somebody. This is just a rumor, but you know, they're saying, hey, this is what I'm, you know, this is what we're hearing. So could be wrong, but that's what we're looking at. I just think that this album, it could come out. The thing is, the people that are worried about the album coming out this year and they think it's not going to come out, they're not using logic. They're thinking with their emotions. Away From the World came out September 11th. 2012. So they had this summer tour and then they released an album then they do a winter tour. So it's just because, what are you gonna say? Just because we don't have a single right now, it's not the end of the world. They could still roll out something. It's much easier than ever. Every year it gets easier and easier to roll out an album, right? You don't need as much time to get the largest chunk of your fans. And also the first week sales thing is actually, that's a hip hop thing. I mean, rock it does. I think now you can tell, like, cause everyone tapers off after their first week. Now it's just like, there's just this huge taper, even in rock and country, unless something happens, unless they are on TV or something. You have these large drop-offs Unless there's like, if there's a TikTok of an album from 5 years ago or 5 months ago, it may gain steam. A single may gain steam, and those singles count towards album equivalent units. So, yeah, it looks like I got some more people, 6 people on. Thank you guys for joining. And again, check out the intro. I made this video while I was in Virginia Beach, but just a beautiful, beautiful background. Yeah, this is just a nice little sunrise. So check this out. If you go to the beginning of the video, you will see it within the first 2 minutes it starts. You can kind of skip through to see. I'll try to timestamp it if I remember after this. I mean, I'm going straight to bed after this. I ain't going to lie. I've been driving on the road. Been on the road today. Oh, hey, Christy, do you have any questions? Any things you want to ask? Like, what's your favorites? Like, what do you like? Anything? What do you want me to answer? Any questions you may have? Any thoughts? But thank you for coming on, Christy W. But yeah, this is a really cool video that I shot during the sunrise. Oh, John, congrats. Oh, thank you. Yeah, some of y'all know, but someone got a ring from me today. That's all I'll say. That's all y'all need to know. That's it. Someone got a ring from me. And things are happening. But yeah, I've been on the road all week. I actually, one thing I'll say about the trip I took, and John knows my driving, but it's not even the fact of how I drive, man. It's not even the speed, because I could deal with the New York drivers, right? I could deal with the New York drivers, the Jersey drivers, the Northern Maryland drivers, and the Northern Virginia, like the traffic is just crazy. I couldn't handle, like this morning, like in like 7 a.m, these Maryland drivers were wilding out. They were wilding out on the road. It was just like, people were like, they weren't letting trucks downhill on different grades get through. There are people that were like right in the left lane. Like, that's the thing is, like, I know I'm not always the fastest driver in certain situations, but I get over it. There were these people in the left lane going slow. Like, it was scary. Like, it was weird. Like, Northern Maryland in the Boone County, you know, shout out to Harford County, H-A-R-F-O-R-D, Harford County. I used to spend summers down in Maryland. But I'm going to get to your question, Christy. But yeah, the drivers in Virginia, like, I don't know, man. Like, once I got across, like, through to Hampton Roads, Bad News, Virginia, which is Newport News. Once I got from there to almost like the Maryland border, like, it was madness. But I kind of was like, I don't know. It just made me feel some type of way. Maybe it's because it was like last year I drove the trip down. It was the pandemic, and now the pandemic's over. And so there was more, much crazy. But even when I went in, I've done some trips prior to 2020 up and down the coast, and it seems better. I don't know, man. It's just a mess. A lot of road work. I thought the pandemic would have got the road work done, but apparently not. Christy W., where are you from? I'm from Hartford, Connecticut. So I live in the greater Hartford area here in Connecticut. So where are you from? You're close to Pittsburgh here, middle of nowhere, actually surrounded by ugly, easier to say Pittsburgh. Gotcha. I know Pittsburgh because I know you got West Virginia. You can claim Pittsburgh if you're just right across the river in West Virginia. There also is the suburbs that go towards the east before you get to the middle of nowhere, Pennsylvania, because it's interesting. You have Philadelphia, you have Pittsburgh, you have Harrisburg kind of in that center of Pennsylvania. And then you have, like, because I've been out there. I've never been to Pittsburgh, but I've been to Philly, I've been to Lancaster, Harrisburg. Like, I've been to that area. That's kind of like a, it's funny, that part of Pennsylvania is just like a feeder to Baltimore almost more than it is to Philly. Like the Harrisburg, York, Lancaster, it's kind of like a feeder to Baltimore sometimes more than Philly, in my opinion. Like it just feels, it feels more like Northern Maryland than it does Philly, right? Or Eastern Pennsylvania. And then I know you have, you have State College, right? I know a couple people who went to Penn State, including a football player, Chris Baker. He grew up in my church, but he was a standout there. Got kind of had to he got kicked off the team. He got into some stuff and fights and stuff. But yeah, I know State College is out there in the middle. But like really, it's, but Pittsburgh, I know you have. It's Morgantown. Like I know it's still a little bit of a drive, right? But you know, for, it's still like Morgantown's a college town, but Pittsburgh is the closest major city to it. So some people from West Virginia, then you have Ohio, right across the border. You have was it Youngstown? I mean, Cleveland, Cuyahoga County is its own little thing, but you have people that are right at that border. You just claim Pittsburgh. I want to get out there because I want to see a Pirates game. 40 minutes north of Pennsylvania, small town, literally 98% white people, but country backwards A people. Just to explain the country area I'm in. Oh, Pittsburgh. You're 40 minutes north of Pittsburgh. Okay. I used to do auto insurance, so I used to have some of the claims. I did Pennsylvania. That was actually like the easiest state to be insured, and you actually didn't. I don't think you need a license to be insured. Like I got a license. I was licensed for the East Coast. Okay, because Pittsburgh. I'm trying to think. Because I remember West Mifflin. I've had accents out there. The various parts of Pittsburgh. My babysitter is from Pittsburgh. When I was a kid, actually 25 years ago, I moved into this development where like my house was built. My parents' childhood home was built about 2 miles from a condo I was in, and I got to see it built, which was really cool. But that neighborhood is like a cul-de-sac of suburban Connecticut. The person who would babysit me a couple years down the road. So 97, we got there around 99, 2000. She's from Pittsburgh. So is her husband. So I know they're out there. I'm going to try to visit them. It's funny. I went to go visit, speaking of Pittsburgh, that family that has Pittsburgh roots, their daughter is out in Baltimore. And we caught up before the Orioles game I went to. Chippy D says, wish Stefan didn't argue with fans so much on Twitter. Kind of sours the band. Yeah, here's the thing. This is why I actually respect Dave Matthews. He realized on Twitter, Dave was ahead of his time. Because Dave actually got off Twitter before. Like he saw how toxic it was getting. He hopped on for a little bit. He's like, hey, why are people just being so mean and whatever? And he hopped off. And here's the thing. As much as I share my opinions, if this stuff is too negative for Dave Matthews, I don't want him listening to this. Turn ConcertBiz 34 off, right? If I'm talking about come tomorrow is trash, turn me off, right? Because for Stefan's mental wellness, and it's better to say nothing sometimes, especially when someone's not worth it. It's one thing, like if Ted Cruz came out and started talking about DNB politics, now Stefan needs to stand. Like, well, he doesn't have to. He can do whatever he wants. But I would understand why he would stand up if Ted Cruz is like on Fox News talking about, oh, those liberals, Dave Matthews and Stefan Lessard. Or even if he says Dave Matthews, that's a valid reason. Because you know why? Ted Cruz is at a high level of public figure. Right? He's supposed to be a public servant, but you know, politicians on both sides of the aisle are trash. There are some great politicians, don't get me wrong, but a lot of them, listen, politicians are worse than, like, people talk about PAC, all this stuff, and listen, the pastor, I mean, is listen, there are some messed up things, right? But politicians are much worse than even the crookedest of pastors. They just criticize the pastors because it takes the pressure off. Anyway, but yeah, I agree. Less is more. I would tell, like, maybe I shouldn't get into Lizzo stuff. I would tell Lizzo, log off. Cardi B, log off of Twitter. Like, some of these celebrities, you are too successful in your field, whether I like your music or not, whether I agree with some of the twerking you do, which I don't. I'll just full disclosure, I don't. Like, put some clothes on, no matter what your size is, put some dang clothes on in public, right? But I think less is Leroy Moore. Talk less, smile more. any Hannibal 10 fans. But it is like, I love how Dave does not engage on social media. He'll actually, and here's the thing, people criticize Dave for talking during the show. What do you think is more engaging? Even if you disagree with Dave, what takes more courage? Posting something on Twitter or speaking out at a concert where fans may walk out or never come back to see you live? You could risk your ticket sales just by saying something on stage. At least Dave is telling people at the show straight up, this is how I feel, right? He's not tweeting it. And I think a lot of what Rashawn tweets gets lost in the mix. Even some of the stuff that Stefan tweets, like the fact that he's arguing, it gives people like a kind of a different view of how they feel. I was in the Withers of the Year. I get trashed for liking DMV, but I don't care. Love the band. And here's the thing. Oh, John Fetterman, great Perth, good dude. And thank you for saying this, Chrissy. Now, again, and this is where it gets a little bit hypocritical, because I'm on the forums because I like to get different perspectives from different people. But sometimes the forums are not a representation of the band. But a lot of people, and this is, again, the diehard fan is asking this question. A lot of people get hurt when their significant other, when their best friend or when their friends don't like DMB. I could care less. There's a video, I don't think it's on, if you dig deep into my archives, you may find it. There's a video of me like in the car driving to Boston and my friend took it. I'm driving. And my friend takes the video and I'm like, oh my God, Dave Matthews comes on. And they turn the volume down while I'm driving. And it's like a joke because they don't like Dave Matthews. And listen, they're great people. They don't like Dave Matthews. Like, it's okay. And here's the thing. Don't let people's negative opinions change. Now, some opinions that you think is negative, and it actually is, like, you need to wake up and listen and smell the coffee. But music is subjective. Right? Except Nickelback. Nickelback suck. No. But still, like, there's stuff I just don't rock with. It's not for me. And that's fine. And like, sometimes it could be a sign. The way you respond. Now, I'm not saying this is Stefan. But like, for instance, on Twitter, there's a lot of conversations about relationships. Right? If you're in a happy relationship, and then Cam Newton says something about this is how he feels about relationships, why would you ever get mad at him, right? If your relationship is so good. And that was a thing that was on Twitter this past week. It was a lot of single women that were upset at Cam Newton. Now, again, you can say what you want. There were some married women, but it's like, if you already have this great life, why are you wasting time arguing with somebody else if everything is good, right? If they're talking about men, but you already have a husband, why argue with them? You already have, it doesn't concern you. Whatever Cam Newton believes, you can disagree, but why yell at him and fight him and say it's X, Y, and Z? That's his opinion. So I think that this is important, that people aren't going to like you. People aren't going to like DMB. People aren't going to agree with where you stand politically, where you stand with your philosophies, but who cares, right? And if people that are close to you can't respect that you like it, even if they don't like the band, but they say, okay, it is what it is. And I'll tell you this, the biggest thing from the D, and this is DMB diehards. This is not a knock on any relationship where there are two people who love DMB. There are so many great people. Shout out to, like, I could think of Jessica in Wisconsin. I could think of Jack in Vegas, right? There are so many great couples. The homies out in Buffalo, Justin and Olivia out in Buffalo, right? They're still doing, you know, I met them at a show. There's nothing wrong with dating someone who loves DMB. But you may, your soulmate or the person, I don't believe in soulmates. Let's not go that down that route. But the person you that may be right for you in the most important ways may not like Dave Matthews Band. They may go to a show even though they don't like them. Or guess what, guys? They may never go to a show because they just can't stand concerts or can't stand DMB. But if they support you going and they love you, go ahead and grab them, because there's not many. Listen, this world, just like there's a shortage of a lot of things, there's a shortage of, like, kind people are all locked up by people because people understand their value. If you have someone who's kind and caring about you and X, Y, and Z, and you want a relationship, lock them up, right? Lock them up, because we don't lock them up. I mean, I'm talking about either make some sort of relationship, union, marriage. Like, I think that some of the, and this is the diehard fans I'm talking to. Some of the, if he doesn't like DMB, I can't date him. Does he listen to you? Does he help you when you're down? Does she listen to you? Does she help you when you're down and not having good things? Does she get along with your family? Right? Does your mom like her? These are things that your mom may not like, boyfriend, girlfriend, husband, but that may, don't let that stop you either. But my point is, it's like people think, oh, I got to be with this person who eats, drinks, and sleeps, David. No. Actually, sometimes it's better when you don't, because then it becomes a thing where you're like, sometimes you're like going at it in different ways because you both love DMB. Now, I'm not saying this happened, because again, I know this, but like sometimes it's not a bad thing to have a partner, a husband, a wife who doesn't like DMB. Plus, if you have kids, they can babysit the kids while you go out with, you know, if they, you go out. The problem is when it's a DMB couple with kids, they got to find a babysitter because both of them want to go to the show equally, right? So anyway, that's just some of my philosophies on that. But I think the takeaway from the Twitter thing, don't waste time responding to people who are not, right, who are not important. Didn't like Dave. I didn't go to a concert until 2005. Hated Dave after seeing the band live. I was obsessed. The vibes, he gives us unforgettable goosebumps. This is me right here. I was a fan of DMB in around that 2005, 2006-ish era. But I never went to a show and I never even checked the live stuff. By a fan, I mean, I heard Ants Marching. I thought it was cool, right? I heard Warehouse. I thought it was cool, right? What Would You Say, right? Satellite. I thought some of these stuff, all right, yeah. I had some of that stuff from, allegedly, from LimeWire, allegedly. Right, I would get that stuff. But what really got me hooked, the reason I am right here is 10 years ago, May 25th, 2012, I went to my first show in Hartford and they opened with The Stone and I was sold from the first notes of The Stone. So I agree. Like, that's what's amazing about this, but you have to kind of see them. And it's the same thing with hockey. I posted, let me get this up here. And oops, that is, you guys are not supposed to see that. That's my folders. Actually, I guess there wasn't anything bad. I posted this earlier in the week, and thank you, Christy. Hopefully, we see you around in the future streams. I stream, Christy. If you're watching, if you're still on, I'm 10 p.m. Eastern on Wednesdays and 10 p.m. Eastern on Saturdays. So 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, Saturdays and Wednesdays. If you miss it live, it's always on the replay. I always save it. The stream is always saved on YouTube. If the stream gets removed, it's probably because there was some sort of copyright issue. And that's really only happened with like the Foo Fighters and other non-DMB stuff that I play during a stream. It'll like actually cause everything to be removed. Let's see. Oh, let me go to my page. Why am I talking about this? Oh, the reason I'm talking about DMB, it's kind of like hockey. I have a picture. Here it is. So 25 years ago, earlier this week, this past Tuesday, was the 25th anniversary of the last Wheelers game. I went to this game. Now, I had been to a game before this in 1996, October 30th, 1996, about 9 days after my 10th birthday. I went to my first Wheelers game, but I was up in the rafters. Went to the last Wheelers game. I was right behind the penalty box about 7 or 8 rows up. It's hard to see here because it zooms in. That's me. That's your boy Conservist 34 right there. But going to that game changed my life. Because I went to that game and saw the speed in person of at the lower part of the ice. By the way, I don't like being that close anymore. Being too close is like a waste of a hockey ticket because you can't see most of the ice that clearly. But seeing that speed led to me learning how to play hockey. Learning to play hockey led to me to play youth hockey. Playing youth hockey led me to play college club hockey and help start be one of the key parts of the first year eligibility for a college club hockey team. I was the treasurer, I believe, of that my senior year, right? I started this program, and the program actually did pretty good after about 3 or 4 years after I graduated. They were into some sort of like ACHA tournament for club hockey. So it wasn't Division 1, 2, or 3. It's below, a little below that. But yeah, that's your boy. So it all started, right? I didn't get to right here in college. This is 10 years ago in 2012. I didn't get to that without starting here, right? Being in person. Hockey is a lot like, it's a lot like DMB. When you see it live, if you can afford it, and that's the other thing too, just like hockey has issues with affordability, if people cannot get a pavilion seat for under $100 for a DMB show, the likelihood someone's going to be a fan is that much lower. Because now the lawn, my first show was on the lawn, right? But sometimes being in that pavilion will be the thing that really turns someone over. Being in the pavilion, seeing the energy on that crowd, I mean, seeing the energy of the crowd and the energy of the band will win people over, will turn people who are non-DMB fans into DMB fans by experiencing being so close. So that's another thing with these ticket price hikes and all that stuff. It really hurts new fans to come in. Because what new fan, you can get someone, like, that's the thing is, my first show, there was like a 4-pack for $20, like $20 per seat. If you got 4. And like, that was a very cheap price to get in. Now it's about almost, it's actually over $60 after fees. Now, yes, it's been 10 years since my first show, but that's still a lot to move up in 10 years for a band that's over 30 years old. So the prices have gone up, and that's going to impact new fans. But getting to that show, however you got to get someone to a show, you will win a lot of people. You're not going to win everyone over. You can't win the world over. But you can win a lot of fans just by them going to the show, not knowing who it is, going with a friend to a show. And it's a very, very awesome thing. He said, oh, that's cool. Yeah. So actually, I'm a Flyers fan now, Christy, because my favorite player, Keith Primo, got traded to the Flyers for Rob Brindamore. So I root against the Penguins. Although I like Malkin, I don't like Crosby. I don't like the way. Now Crosby's one of the best players in the NHL, and he'll go down in his era. You have Ovechkin and Crosby, but Crosby, you could argue points for him being the best in his era and out of his draft class, but I root against him. I respect how good he can be. I just don't like some of the stuff. But let's see what Chrissy says. I agree with the pricing. Tickets enough, but I'm in the fan club, so it's worth it for $40 a year. But I get tickets at a cheaper rate. Literally, you have a chance for pit tickets for $300 when $1,000 on Ticketmaster. And Chrissy, I gotta say, listen, I feel like you're gonna fit in great on this stream with the other community members. My biggest thing with the warehouse, people, I don't want to continue. It's $40 a year, and you get a chance at tickets at face value. This year, I got SPAC Night 2. 2018, I got SPAC Night 2. 2017, I got Dave and Tim SPAC Night 1. That's three confirmations in SPAC of over like 8 years of requesting both nights or some sort of combination like that. So most of the time, I've been rejected or declined from SPAC. But for like a year like this year, the face value is well worth it. It would be like some of the tickets for SPAC are $300, $400. Some of the closer seats like right to the pit or by the pit are over $1,000 on secondary marketplaces. So the fact that I only have to pay $40 a year and I have a chance of getting tickets at a cheaper rate. And then if I go to more shows like I do, right? So I'm going to Hartford Mansfield, SPAC. That's four. Alpine, that's six. Deer Creek, that's eight. I'm going to eight shows this year. So $40 spread amongst those tickets, right? That's not that much money when each of them is the opportunity. And I did get certain stuff confirmed. So and I got Pitt for Hartford, right? I don't always get, I've only had Pitt for Hartford in 2015. I go for Hartford every year. But it's well worth it because I got a face value pit ticket. I'm not selling it, right? I'm going to the show. Lord willing, I'm going to the show. So I got a face value pit ticket at my home venue. I'll pay that $40. Add it as like just a whatever fee. It's like I think of it, I got a pit ticket and I got a $40 service charge on top of it. But it's well worth it because it's the pit. Are you going to Cuyahoga Falls, Blossom? Okay. Oh, yeah, they're not coming to Burgettstown. Right, that is interesting. They came back. They did bring it back last year, and the show sounded amazing. I actually, if you want to check it out, if you go through my archives, I have a post-show stream of that. I have a post-show stream of Cuyahoga and Star Lake or Burgettstown. So that'll be good, but thank you guys for being on again, 10 p.m. Eastern, Saturdays and Wednesdays, the beginning of the show. If you missed it, Christy, there's an awesome intro. If you go back to the beginning of this show, when I log off, you'll see an awesome intro of Dive In, and it's dope. Beautiful. All right, that's all I have for today. But again, I will see you guys on Wednesday. So again, Wednesday and Saturday, Eastern, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Wednesdays and Saturdays. All right. This is your boy, Constantvince34. I'm signing off. Have a wonderful night.